Let's speak to Dr. Jade McGlynn, Director of Research and Russian Studies Fellow at the Henry Jackson Society. Evening, Doctor.
Hello, good evening, Phil. Thank you for inviting me on again.
Oh, no, it's a pleasure. I think it's important that you bring our audience as much of a Russian perspective on this as you can. Have you been able to gather what Russia is saying about this? I mean, for example, Lord West there just said he didn't believe any high-explosive bombs were dropped, but that's central to Russia's claim today, isn't it?
It is central to their claim. So certainly, as a British person reading the Russian newspapers or watching Russian TV today, you would have been quite alarmed about what was happening in the Black Sea. Luckily, Jonathan Beale was there, I think, to calm some nerves. But on my part, so in terms of the Russian view or the version that's being put out, it's very much about, as you've already mentioned, it's very much about the warning shots and that these four bombs were dropped. But also a really key part of the disinformation campaign is the idea that the Royal Navy was frightened away and that the HMS Defender sort of sailed back when presented with the might of the Russian Navy and their tactics. In fact, we know that HMS Defender continued its route to Batumi in Georgia. So we're quite clear that that isn't true. However, that's a really important point, and it makes sense why, because pretty much very few people recognize these waters, the waters around Crimea, as Russian. So if you put yourself in Russia's shoes, a very important part of projecting your power and your ownership over this region is through the threat that you're able to project. And then some ship turns up from the Royal Navy and sails right through your waters without really too much hassle, perhaps a little bit more hassle and confrontation than the MOD might admit, but without too much hassle. That doesn't bode well that reflects badly perhaps on your ability to project your ownership of these waters.
And the projection of the ownership, Jade, is that for the international communities or is it for a domestic audience for Putin? Where's his priority?
Mm-hmm. So domestic audiences are always the priority, but it's very hard to extricate the international, so the foreign policy, from the domestic policy, often when it comes to Russian politics, because the international scene is so important. So much of Putin's key argument is not just that I've returned stability to Russia, but also that I've made Russia a great power again after the humiliations of the 1990s and the collapse of the Soviet Union, and being told, well, you'll be treated the same as sort of any other country. He's made Russia back into a great power. There's even sort of a term for it in Russian, velika derzhavnost, great powerness. And this is something that Putin's seen as returning. So it's not necessarily that easy to extricate the two.
President Putin says, and Lord West alluded to this, he said that it's NATO that he doesn't really like. He's quoted as saying that the NATO alliance is refusing to consider in a constructive manner our proposals on de-escalating tension and reducing the risk of unpredictable incidents in these waters. And what do you interpret by that?
Well, NATO is a very convenient brigand because, as Lord West pointed out, I mean, lots of Russians don't particularly like NATO, and I don't think that's, I think that is quite easy to understand why they might not like NATO. It's not a question of right or wrong. It's just from the Russian point of view, you can see why NATO may not be perceived as being in its best interest. I mean, a lot of the complaints around NATO are actually as well just a projection of the intense militarization that Russia has been carrying out in the Black Sea region and particularly around Crimea since 2014 and its annexation of the peninsula. So a lot of the time this is a deflection exercise as well, because Russia has been very busy sort of restoring the nuclear infrastructure on the peninsula and also, you know, transporting there all manner of different weapons, including the Calibri missiles, which are capable of carrying nuclear warheads. So often some of these complaints around NATO should slightly makes you worry. And okay, well, what have they brought in now to Crimea?
Thank you very much for your analysis, Dr. Jade McGlynn, Director of Research and Russian Studies Fellow at the Henry Jackson Society.